Docker is a hugely popular technology used to develop and run applications. Knowing how to use it is an essential skill for any developer. In today's video, you'll learn the most important parts about Docker. I'll walk you through the process of containerizing a simple Python-based application and explain to you fundamental concepts like Docker files, images, and containers. I'll show you how to build your application, run it locally, and deploy it to the cloud. But before that, we need to answer, what is Docker? At its heart, Docker is a tool used to bundle your application so that it can be deployed on any machine. It packages up the entirety of your app so that it runs the same on your machine, my machine, the cloud, anywhere. It's hardware agnostic, so it works the same even when being used on Windows, Macs, or Linux machines. This is the entire point of Docker, to get rid of the works on my machine problem so that apps deploy and run consistently across systems. To understand how Docker works, you need to learn three important concepts: Docker files, images, and containers. A Docker file is the starting point for your application. It contains a series of commands that specify how to run your program. This includes things like copying directories, installing dependencies, and running your main process. A Docker file builds into an executable package called an image. Images include everything needed to run your program, including code, runtime, libraries, environment variables, and configuration files. Images usually inherit from a base image that contains pre-installed dependencies that you can build on and use right away. The Docker Hub has a ton of publicly available images that you can use as a starting point for your project. A container is a runnable instance of an image. You can deploy many containers at once, including on your own machine, or deploy through a cloud provider like AWS or Microsoft Azure. If your application is running a critical workload and needs constantly running containers, you can use a container orchestration system like Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, or AWS's ECS or EKS services to manage the lifecycle and scale up your application. So those are the basics. But the best way to learn Docker is to create and deploy a project of your own. I'm now going to show you how to Dockerize a sample Python-based application and deploy it to the AWS cloud. I'll provide you the accompanying code and necessary commands on GitHub so you can follow along. Feel free to skip around if you're already familiar with some of the concepts. So let's get started with installing Docker. To get started using Docker, we first need to install the Docker client. Head over to the Docker website and install the Docker engine. Docker is currently supported on all major platforms, including Linux, Mac, and Windows. Select your platform type to download the installer. After running the installation wizard, you should notice a Docker icon in your system tray. Double-clicking on this icon will bring up the Docker desktop client. The desktop client provides a user-friendly interface to visualize and manage your Docker resources, like containers, images, and volumes. You can also view past builds and use the newly released Docker Scout feature to analyze your images for security vulnerabilities. While you're at it, you should consider installing the Docker extension for VS Code. This extension provides command autocomplete and makes it easier to navigate Docker infrastructure directly within your editor. Project setup within Docker is a breeze thanks to some new command line tools that make it easier to set up your project. First, type docker --version to confirm everything is set up correctly on your CLI. We'll be using the docker init command to set up our initial project with the necessary files. First, we need to select our language of choice, in which case we'll choose Python. We can also specify the version number or accept the default, and we can choose our port number that we'd like the Docker container to listen on. Here, I'm selecting port 80. Next, we need to provide the startup command that Docker will use when it starts our container. Here, I'm just telling it to run the app.py file, which we'll create in a moment. Pressing enter completes the initialization for our project. You'll notice a handful of files were created for you as part of the setup. The docker ignore file is used to specify which files and directories should be ignored by the Docker build process. The compose.yaml file is used to define and run multi-container Docker applications. The Docker file contains instructions to build our Docker image, and the README file provides some additional documentation to learn and use Docker. For now, I'm going to empty out the compose.yaml and Docker file so we can start out with a clean slate. We'll go ahead and create an app.py file to write our Flask code. We'll import some dependencies and create an instance of our app, and then we'll create a simple API endpoint that returns some placeholder text. This isn't a sophisticated app, but it's just meant to get you started so that you could add more functionality later. Finally, we use the app.run command, providing it a localhost IP address and the port we'd like the app to run on. Next, we create a requirements.txt file and drop in the Flask dependencies so that we can incorporate it into our application. Next comes adding to our Docker file. In line 1, we're using the from command and adding the Python base image with a 3.10.2 version tag. This is an official image from Docker Hub that already has Python pre-installed. Next, we specify the application working directory. Then we copy everything from the current directory to the Docker's/app directory. To ensure that Flask is installed, we need to run the pip install and give it a reference to our requirements.txt file. We use the expose command to open up port 8080, the same port that our Flask app is listening for traffic on, and then run the cmd command to instruct Docker to run our app.py file on startup. Before we can run our image in a container, we first need to build it. For this, we use the Docker build command with the -t flag to give our image a name. You can optionally provide a tag to your image by separating the name with a colon and the tag name. The period at the end specifies the build context, which is our current working directory. Pressing enter now will trigger the build, including downloading all the base image dependencies and stepping through each line in our Docker file. To start up the container with this image, we use the docker run command. Using -p allows us to control port mappings. We provide 127.0.0.1 to denote the port is only accessible on localhost, and then map port 8080 on the host to port 8080 on our container. Finally, we provide the name of the image that we would like to run. Now that our application is running, we can visit it on localhost port 8080 to verify it's working. If we bring up our browser, we can see that the container started up successfully and is serving up our content. With a running container, you can start to see the value of Docker Desktop. In this tool, you're able to quickly click on each running container and inspect things like logs and other configurations. You can also stop, restart, and delete the container if you so choose from this UI. Another important concept about Docker to understand are Docker volumes. Volumes allow you to share data between your host machine and your Docker containers, and they allow you to persist data even after your containers have been shut down. Using volumes, you can map a folder on your host machine to a folder on your container. With this setup, you can access host files from your container and vice versa. Here's a quick example. Here, I'm running our image with the -v command and providing it a host path of /users. The path after the second colon indicates the folder in the container of where the contents will be present. If you open up your Docker Desktop and head over to the bind mount section, you can verify that the folder was attached successfully. A different way to use volumes is by creating a named volume. Named volumes store data on your host machine, but manage the contents for you. Here I'm using the volume create command and providing it the name of our volume. Now with the docker run command and the -v flag, we can provide it the name of our shared volume alongside the path that we would like to store the volume in our container. Here I'm calling it my_path. Now within Docker Desktop, under the volume section, we can see that the shared volume has been created and is currently in use. We can then navigate over to our container section and see that it is currently being used as well. As you can see here by the blue indicator, my path in the container is referencing our volume. Docker Compose is another useful feature that lets us run multiple containers at once on the same host machine. This can be useful in cases where you have two distinct processes, say an API and a database, and would like to run them both at once on a single host. To use this feature, you need to create a special compose.yaml file that contains the configuration for all of your containers. In our case, our Docker Compose file contains three top-level fields: services, volumes, and secrets. Services indicate the containers you'd like to deploy. Volumes are the ones that you'd like to use, and secrets are for the sensitive data like passwords or access keys that you'd like to keep private. The server service is for our Flask API. Within it, we define the build context, the port mappings, and a nifty new feature called Docker Watch, which allows you to automatically rebuild your application anytime you change your code. The DB container uses the Postgres image and references a secrets entry, a volume we'd like to use, environment variables, our port of choice, and a health check configuration. Finally, the volume section defines a named volume, and the secret section a reference to a secrets file that we store on disk. Running our containers using Compose requires some slightly different syntax. This time we use the Docker Compose up and build flag to build and run the containers in our Compose file. Now in Docker Desktop, we're able to see both of our containers running at once. Now, deploying your application locally is one thing, but you may be wondering, how do I go about getting my application onto the cloud so that customers can start using it? For this, we're going to use AWS or Amazon Web Services. Now, AWS has a whole bunch of services, and there are many different ways to deploy containers onto AWS. Now, there's no right or wrong way, but there are certain pros and cons for going with the various approaches. By far, the most popular choices are Elastic Kubernetes Service and Elastic Container Service. Both of these examples can be used to manage the lifecycle of your container. They provide infrastructure in a serverless mode and can be scaled up to handle tons of traffic. ECS is by far the most popular if you're already integrated in the AWS ecosystem, so we'll be going with that in this example to deploy our Flask API. Now, in order to get started with ECS, we first need to upload our image into Elastic Container Repository, or ECR for short. This is the equivalent of Docker Hub, but owned by AWS. To get started, we first need to log in to ECR using the following command. Make sure to substitute your region and your account ID. If everything worked, you should see a login succeeded pop-up like we see here. Now we can tag our image to prepare it for the upload into ECR. Again, make sure to substitute your account ID and your region that you're using. We can now push our image to ECR using the push command. Notice though that we're getting an error that the repository does not yet exist. To address this, we will go into the AWS console to create the repository. In the ECR service under the repository section, click on Create Repository. Then give your repository a name and scroll down to click Create Repository. If we try the push command once more, you'll see that it succeeds and the image gets pushed to ECR without an issue. Now we can go to the ECS service and create something called a cluster. A cluster just contains infrastructure that we'll use to host our service. After selecting Create Cluster, we'll give it a name, and then we'll go ahead and select the AWS Fargate or serverless mode for our infrastructure. Then we can go ahead and click on Create. Next, we need to create a task definition, which is essentially a blueprint for our application. After clicking Create, we go ahead and give it a name, ensure that we still have AWS Fargate selected, then specify the CPU and memory that we need, before finally selecting None as the task role. Finally, we need to provide some details for the container. We need to give the container a name, and then the repository URI, which can be retrieved from the ECR section of the console. The last step is to specify the port mapping, which is 8080 for our Docker container, which will be 8080 on our host machine. Now you can scroll all the way down and click on Create. Now that our task definition is created, we can deploy our service using the cluster we created previously. You just need to scroll down and give your service a name before clicking on Create in the bottom right. After a few brief moments, it'll deploy our task onto our Fargate service. We'll know it's done when the task status changes to running. Then we can click on our task, grab the public IP address, and then paste it into our browser on port 8080 to verify that it's working. If you have trouble, you may need to add a security group setting that looks like this one to enable connectivity. And just like that, you learned everything you need to know about Docker and deployed a container into the cloud.